You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. On this episode, I had an intro all planned and I've completely forgotten it as I've hit record. But on this edition, I've got a returning guest on the show, one that I can't believe it's taken this long to get back on properly, because last time this person was on, it was episode 58 and it was July 2021. And here we are, September 2024. It will be episode 305 on this edition.
Jeez.
It's Ellie Armstrong. Welcome back.
Thank you for having me back. I'm so excited to be here.
Well, considering the last time you were on, you had, what, six matches?
Yeah. F that. Like, and one of them was like 3 minutes long. So even if you can count that as a match. So.
Because it was, you were very kindly a last minute drop in. Because I think I think it was Aspen was supposed to be on there. No, nice and early for the sheet there for the bingo card. And then yeah, he pulled out and I was like, anyone want to be on? And you were like, yeah, I'll do it.
Last minute drop in. There's the new chant. There we go.
But I think we did pretty good. Well, we got like over an hour in somehow of chat and
we made it through my laptop not wanting to connect to the internet whatsoever. So
I think back in 2021 mine was the same before I decided to use this whole system instead.
Yeah, I've got a proper hardwired internet connection this time, so fingers crossed, no internet connectivity issues.
Well, that's the jinx. So we'll see how long it takes. Last time we did that, I went on about my internet being amazing. It was Martin McAllister's episode, and it just died. Everything died in the episode, and it just kept dying. Anyway. We'll be fine.
We'll be good. We'll be grand.
So how's it going? It's been a long 3 years.
It has. A lot has changed, and not just my hair. It's been good. Ups and downs. Obviously, championship win, very good. Championship loss, not so good. And a lot of debuts. I think I'd maybe only worked for two or three. Maybe even two companies last time we spoke. Maybe not even that. Maybe it was just ICW.
You just did your WWE Network stuff and then that was it.
Just the network.
Just making the debut of one of the biggest streaming services for wrestling ever. Shame they're all gone now, though. They're taken off.
Saved as much as I could, but there's still some clips I don't have, but I'm sure I could get them if I asked. But looking back on some of my early clips, I'm like, I think my wrestling has definitely improved since then.
You're quite glad first ones are kind of gone.
Yeah. I really do like my debut match against Molly Spartan. I think I'm very, to this day, very proud of that. But I think myself and Molly could run that match back now. And it would be 10 times better. We would put on a way better show. She's obviously gotten so much better in the 3 years, but I think I've just grown in confidence as well. So I would like a wee run it back with Molly if the opportunity arises.
Yeah, we popped into Scotland recently, didn't she, for Mythos during the Fringe. So she had a couple of matches, but stars did not align at that moment in time. One day, definitely. But yeah, like I said, yeah, it was the last match I've got noted before this episode went out properly was against Anastasia. So that was, a good long time ago. And then
I've retired her since then, so no big deal.
First accolade on the sheet for Armstrong.
Anastasia.
I mean, since then, though, we'll pick and choose some matches as we go, as we speak about it, but you made your debut for CPW, which is a place we're going to speak about quite a bit in this episode. Iron Girders, Pro 2. So you've made your way around TNT as well, which again, another place we'll
definitely speak.
You've done all right. Done all right in the last few years or so. But I mean, the first note I've got here is I was listening to your chat with Ella at the Wrestling Gal. I know when she put out the episode, I was like, how dare Ella undercut me with an interview with Ellie Armstrong? Not like she's got a much bigger platform than I do, but you know, I'm just saying, I'm watching you, Ella. But to it was going back through things like things that you've been able to accomplish and some of the maybe more surprising facts about yourself, like you're not just a wrestler that can do all manner of things, but you're also got the smarts behind it as well. When people saw that, were people aware? Did you have any people come to you and message you about it, going, "Oh my God, I can't believe you've actually got like a degree and you've got this behind you as a failsafe if the wrestling for whatever reason passes you by."
A few folk, yeah, they were quite surprised. There was a few folk that already knew. Cassie the Lassie brings it up all the time. She's like, "Do you know she's actually quite smart?" And I'm like, "I don't like the way you're saying that, Cassie." I mean, like, I get it, but also phrase that differently, Cassandra. Come on, jeez. Omar mentioned it to me. Omar Muhammad, he didn't know at all. But I've only just kind of met him anyway. But he was like, "I didn't realize." And we talked about our degrees a bit, and I was like, "Yeah." But people see physics and go, "Oh wow, amazing!" But it's just maths. If you can do maths, you can do physics.
I gave up. Well, I didn't give up on math. I was quite good at maths, and then they started introducing things like letters, and I was like, "Nah."
The letters were my favorite part of maths because you could just make it up. Like, sure, 3x equals y. Why not? Like,
no, that's when it stopped being logical at that point, and my brain just went, "Nah, that this doesn't make sense. Just patch it. Get out. Go get a job instead. Just let's do that instead." And here I am, 17 years later, and I'm doing a podcast.
Maths would have been no use for a podcast anyway, so
exactly.
You make the right decision.
Exactly. The only time it becomes useful is when I look at the time thinking, "Have I hit an hour yet?" Or, "Oh no, have I?" And then I have to try and guess. I'm trying to remember. Actually, it's more memory, because I have to remember when I started hitting record. Anyway. So back onto the actual wrestling side of things. I have questions about Taylor Swift as well. Don't you worry. We'll definitely get into that. But your wrestling side of things. One of the things I remember speaking about was you wanting to try and like kind of get this spooky tag team going on. You wanted to try and get something like that going on. And not long after we had the chat, a couple months later, the Powerhouse Bitch Slayers were born with Ruby Roberts. So I was down at Respect Pro Wrestling. I think one of their final shows-ish.
I think it was their second to last show,
So that's when you kind of got to unleash a different side of Ellie Armstrong. You weren't just the vegan-based, plant-based powerhouse. I'm just making up names for you now. You got to get the old dark eyeliner and all that kind of stuff. Was that the thing? Because that was originally what you wanted to be, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That kind of character. So did you got to live that dream for a moment.
For a bit. I've had it. I'm kind of glad I didn't go down the spooky route because it's not me, but it's fun. Like, I like tagging with Ruby. I think we've got very similar styles. I think we work well together. We've obviously had our wee tete-a-tetes throughout the years, but I do think we work better as a team. And I would like to tag with Ruby more. That would be fun. I think the plant-based slayers, we do well. We do well.
I mean, I don't think there's enough tag teams, women's tag teams, certainly in Scotland or the UK.
I just don't think there's enough tag teams, full stop, in Scotland. I'm looking for a friend. I've got a few lined up. Ruby being one. Myself and Martin McAllister are trying to maybe get a team going. So we sneak peek for you, Billy.
I was seeing some of the videos from coming out of Community Pro, and the vegan agenda is certainly starting to take shape.
We're trying. We're pushing it.
which is weird. Seeing yourself and Martin, who like on any given day look like the nicest people in the world, and then suddenly you go and get into this orbit with each other and this agenda, and I'm just watching it going, how can those two nice people just be a bit mean? It's just fascinating how.
See, I can tell you why, Billy, because CPW management, everyone knows how they keep screwing me over. They keep adding folk to my singles matches, making them triple threats, making me lose the belt, had lost the belt without getting pinned, and then they didn't give me a rematch. And then it's the same with Martin. They were happy to book him while he was on this long losing streak that was mostly not his fault. He was getting screwed over during that. And then suddenly he wins the Girders title, and oh, why don't you come back? Why don't you come back? They're glory hunting. That's what they're doing. They just want the stars.
I mean, in some ways, it's a bit more of a compliment. In a glimmer of compliment. They're wanting you there because they want the biggest names on their shows. But yeah, at the same time, they're also taking advantage of your good nature and and throwing extra people in matches. We will speak about Mary Hell a little bit later on, because we've still got about 3 years to just pick and choose matches and opponents that I want to speak about first. One of which being Alexis Falcon.
Mm-hmm.
So you wrestled her at ICW. It was a brief match, but Alexis went on to do amazing things with the Cheeky Little Buggers with Charles Crowley. As someone who's outside of Scotland, someone coming up to wrestle, and you getting a chance to be in the ring with her, was that a learning experience for yourself? I mean, at this point, it was just over a year in you were, and you were getting in the ring with Alexis Falcon. Was that a big learning experience for you?
Yeah, definitely. And it was a big, I want to say, like, milestone. Like, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, someone will tell me I'm wrong, but I think it was the first person based out with Scotland that I wrestled. So it was the first time someone was coming up to wrestle me, and it was one of the people on my wrestling bucket list to wrestle. And I'm really sad that we've only actually ever had one match together. So I hope she heals up soon from her current injury and I get to wrestle her again soon. But yeah, I learned a lot. It was so interesting to see just how she went about going through the matches, how different moves that I'd never taken before, because I think everyone bar Emily Hayden I had trained with, everyone that I'd wrestled up to Alexis Falcon I had trained with, so I knew the moves, I knew how to take them, whereas I was coming into a completely different move set with Alexis Falcon, a completely different way of planning, a way of working, and it was quite a steep learning curve, because obviously I'd never met her before. I met her maybe 3 hours before the show started. We didn't have a lot of time to go over things, so it was a good, sometimes I think you just need to be flung at the deep end for things like this, and it thankfully went well. I still look back on that as one of my higher up ranked matches in my career so far.
And am I right in thinking you're a bit of a Disney kid yourself? So that kind of dynamic.
Yeah. More of like, I always say I'm not. And then I think of all my favorite films and they're all Disney, Pixar, Star Wars films. And I'm like, oh yeah, I think I am.
But Alexis, of course, she, well, I don't know if she still does it, but she had her Disney series because she was there like every month, it felt like, as well. So it's someone that, yeah, you're able to kind of bond not only in a wrestling kind of dynamic, but also in a personal level, which I think from what I've learned.
What we did bond over was Crocs. We both love our Crocs. So that was a good bonding experience between the two of us.
See, I'm tempted. I've got the Tesco version, which I call Gators, because
I got the Tesco version before I got my first ever pair of Crocs, and because I think they were like £3,
mm-hmm.
and then I was like, as soon as I got the Tesco version, I was like, oh, I need an actual pair of Crocs now, because these were so comfy, and I was like, if Crocs are like 10 times the price, then they've got to be even comfier than this. They are worth it. Get them in the sale though.
Oh yeah,
gone up in price.
I'll bear that in mind. When I bought them, I was like, yeah, I was kind of like my starter, my prelude to getting actual Crocs, and one day I will. But your camera's glitching, and that's terrifying me because I had Monstrum on yesterday.
Oh no!
So we'll just. I'm sure it'll be fine, but it just caught my eye. I was like, "Oh God, he's back! Monstrum is back." Which is weirder because in the timeline of these episodes going out, his is going out on Friday the 13th. This is going out on the 11th, so it's even scarier for me. Anyway, right, we'll move on. So Alexis Palkin.
Oh, it's still going. Kind of like
you jinxed it.
A little bit with the back of it. It's the cat. I'm blaming the cat. Give me 2 seconds. Oh, I don't know. I think I'd be good with technology. I'm not.
Well, math's involved with technology. It's fine.
This is horrendous. Jeez, oh. I think I'm making it worse. We'll cut this, yeah.
And we're back, I think.
Yeah, I think we're back. We're good now.
So the last thing we spoke about was Alexis Falcon. Then somehow I mentioned Monstrum, and then the feed died. So. Yeah.
Oh, he's coming to get me.
Looking forward to Friday the 13th now when that episode goes out. Moving forward, though, we'll try to as we can. After that match, you Iron Girders, you properly started diving into Iron Girders properly. You had a match with the She-Wolves, which I'm assuming another one that was kind of on your bucket list of matches to have. And then it was the IGPW Championship Tournament. So,
yeah.
All I've seen of these girder shows is the fans just, they want wrestling. That is just, yeah. it's a good kind of, not a low ring, but it echoes nicely. Was girders where you started training, wasn't it? Or was GPWA, if I remember
it was
rightly?
GPWA where I started training, and then during COVID when like they were allowing classes back, but the classes had to be a certain size, it was just after Wolfgang opened girders, and they had like, sort of a wee alliance going, and they were like, we'll take half the classes so that they can be smaller, and obviously they had the ring as well. And then when things started opening up, Girders was like, we're going to be our own school now. I don't really know what went down, but Girders is closer to my house, and that's why I train there. And now the asylum, there's no, I'm just lazy, there's no actual reason behind it.
I mean,
both skills are great. I'm just too lazy to get a bus into town when I can walk 5 minutes around the corner and go to Girders.
That's fair. I mean, and at the same time, like, both have their plus points. I mean, GPWA, you're more likely to maybe get moved forward to ICW, but at Girders, I'm sure that you could train at both schools. They're not going to be like, no, you train here, you can't train there. But
there's loads of folk that do both, yeah.
Yeah, but you get the feedback of like Wolfgang, who's in the performance center and all that kind of stuff. So both have merits and opportunities and all that good stuff. But the tournament arrived. I was just checking your opponents. You had Thatcher Wright. Terrible person.
And
Leon Graves as well. So Leon was, I don't know if he's injured just now or just taking a break, but he was a guy that seemed to be really kind of, he was going to be the next guy,
yeah.
But see what he does. But getting to wrestle in Iron Girders in that environment, in that kind of atmosphere, it's probably as close at that point you're going to get to like an ICW crowd without being an ICW, and you had the closed door matches. So what was like the atmosphere getting to wrestle in Iron Girders?
I love the Girders shows that are actually in Girders. Are my favorite shows to do. You've got that kind of, as you said, it's a wrestling crowd. A lot of the folk there are there to see wrestling. Like they're wrestling fans. They know what's going on and that, but it's also a family show. So you've got kids there and they're all super excited. And I love doing family shows. Like over 18 shows are cool. You can swear, but I think making Making happy memories for kids, I think, is what wrestling is really about for me, anyway. Or bad memories, because I'm usually shouting at them. But at girders, I'm not. At girders, I'm high-fiving everyone, gassing myself by double high-fiving everyone in the audience before I get to the ring. It's always fun.
I've experienced LA family show, LA who likes to shout and make people cry. Of course, at the Peterhead shows, which it's just a fun atmosphere. It's fun. It's great being able to see someone enjoy it as well, because you'll know yourself when you see a wrestler that's maybe not confident enough at these family shows, that the kids will be merciless. They will just they'll let you know, "Oi, I've paid money. Well, my mom's paid money to see this. Do something." But you're very, very, very happy just to give them something to boo about at those shows. I mean, to the point where, of course, our Peterhead, first time I saw you at Peterhead, we did a little interview in the stands at
They
Peterhead
wouldn't
Football
leave
Club.
me alone.
They would not leave you alone. It was the amount of, I had to learn how to blur backgrounds. That was
Positives come from everything.
Bloody kids, I had to learn how to blur. That was like 5 days of just, I didn't know how to do this. I still don't know how to do it, really. If you asked me to do it again, I'd be like, I have no idea. But it was the fact that they were doing it, so they were doing it for your character, and that just makes you, does that just make you think, yeah, I'm doing my job right if this is how wild these kids are getting, because I've just beaten up the cool Jasmine for 10 minutes, but here they are just absolutely laying into me,
I
verbally,
think it,
thankfully.
yeah. I think it would get to me if they were, if all the jabs were, "Oh, you're rubbish. Oh, you're," I don't know, some sort of like weight or gender based insult. But they all genuinely, especially I think at that show, they were all shouting like "cheater" because I cheated in the match. So they, one, that tells me they watched and at least took in the match. I don't know if they enjoyed it. I'm not going to say for certain they enjoyed it, but they watched and absorbed the match and were, what's the word? Their attention was on it. I can't think of the actual word.
Yeah,
so
they weren't trying to take, they weren't taking a personal barb at you or at your weight or your gender, but
and
they
they
were
were,
going for the character itself.
Yeah, and they weren't sitting on their phones during the match. They know I cheated because they were watching it. So that makes you feel like you've done your job as the baddie, and then they've also enjoyed the show that they've paid to see. Like, that's all you can ask. If their way of enjoying it is to follow us into the stands of Peterhead Football Club and shout "cheater" at me for 10 minutes, then there's not a lot to do up north, no offense, Billy, so gotta let them enjoy it.
I mean, I would argue with you, but kinda, really. I mean, I don't think I've left the house that much in the last 2 years, but I would like to blame my son for it, but no, I don't like leaving the house. It's just all my stuff's here.
That's fair. Yeah.
Why would I need to leave when I've got all my crap?
Yeah, my cats are here. They don't leave the house, so why should I?
Exactly. It's like they seem to have a good life. Why?
They're pampered.
Live like a cat, or in my case, live like a dog who just like begs for food, gets fed, falls asleep. What a life! I would.
Oh, that's also my cat's life, except they do it at like 3 in the morning, and it's really annoying. That's my partner's job to deal with that. That's not mine.
I'm the nighttime guy as well for things like that, because when it comes to operate, because this is where I work in this office as well, so I don't have to commute. I can look like utter rubbish and nobody's going to notice or care. As long as I get my work done, everyone leaves me alone. That's the best bit.
Yeah,
anyway,
one.
Wrestling. So another match should pop
on
up.
This wrestling podcast.
I know.
How dare we talk about cats?
I mean, I'm saying that like I haven't done the first episode of the season was me and Ian Skinner talking about Starship Troopers for almost 2 hours and nothing else. So
yeah,
you know,
that's fair.
It's very loosey goosey on the term of Scottish wrestling podcast. Yes, back to wrestling. So ICW, back to there for a little bit, because we'll talk about you teamed with Rio against the She-Wolves.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, Rio at the moment is just blowing up. everywhere.
Amazing. Yeah.
Progress, ICW, Abroad. Every time that there's mention of WWE looking at the UK Indies, Rio's name's there. What was it like getting in the ring with her? I mean, have you wrestled her yet, or it was just teaming with her you've been so far?
I've only teamed with her. It was just an honour that I was picked to tag with her in the first place. I was like, whoa, this is like that's a big rub in itself. And then it was just, even though I wasn't facing her, I was teaming with her, there's just so much you could learn. I love like listening to the way that we all planned the match, and just, she's just so strong and powerful, and it was just an honor to share the ring with her for the brief, I think, 10-15 minute match that we had.
And it's one of those you can just watch, because if for whatever reason part of the match was Rio getting beaten up by the She-Wolves, you could just sit back and just like watch three people that have got all this experience, and you're just sitting there like taking it all in and
going like,
to...
how did I end up here? Wow. Yeah.
But I mean, moving on to things like that, you had the Rainbow Rumble not long after that. We're tearing through the last 3 years of bits and pieces, so we'll probably jump back and forth as we go. Really, I want to talk about Taylor Swift, but we'll get the wrestling stuff out of the way. Rainbow Rumble, TNT, Effie's Big Grey Brunch in 2023, back in May. It's these big gay brunch shows, whether it's the US or whether it's in Liverpool, are always got a huge fanfare of shows, and it's a great way for people to learn about wrestlers that are on the spectrum's popped into my mind. I don't think that word I'm looking for. Don't think it is. But on the
what you mean.
Yeah,
both apply. It's fine.
On the LGBTQ plus
wavelength flag.
Yeah, we'll go with that. Yes, we'll go with that. That's terrible.
I know what you mean.
Yeah, we're all right. But yeah, that it's a celebration anyway of people that are either allies or are waving the flag themselves. There we go, saved it. What's it like to be part of those shows, part of that show specifically, and being in the ring with not only people that you've obviously know, like DCT and Drew Mercury and that through the ICW shows, but being able to be on a show with the likes of Priscilla and FA and being involved in all that kind of stuff?
To this day, that's still that show. I was only in the Rainbow Rumble for 5 minutes. I've never timed it, but it was definitely less than 10. But I would still count that whole show as one of my top five wrestling experiences since I started. Like, the whole atmosphere, the whole day, from the moment so I travelled down with Drew Mercury, and from the moment we arrived, it was just so fun, so welcoming. It was the first time I'd met 90% of the people there, so I was a bit overwhelmed. I was like, oh, so many people that I've only seen on Twitter or YouTube or Instagram, things like that. But everyone was so lovely, and when it came to like planning the Rumble, everyone was like, oh, I'd love to do a spot with you, I'd love to do a spot with you. And I was like, me? Oh, thank you. And like I made so many friends that day, like people that I still talk to and are still like, oh, we should wrestle one day, and I'm like, yeah, we should, but I don't drive, so me getting to England's quite hard. Yeah, absolutely, like the atmosphere even backstage, even while the show was going on, so chill. Getting to meet like Effie and Ali was like a dream. Love them so much, and being able to watch the main event with Shane Monet and Effie and Ali, and that was just incredible, and I loved every second of that day.
It's just incredible in the best way possible that we're in an environment now in wrestling where people are allowed to express themselves, and with like back, we're talking about Peter Head, the people are talking about the character and not picking on physical attributes or anything like that. They're respecting the wrestler and reacting accordingly. And nowadays, you've got enough wrestlers that are open and able to speak about what part of the flag that they're on and all that kind of stuff. Can't get the word spectrum out of my head. I'll remember the word after we finish recording. Yeah. But they're allowed to just express themselves so openly, and the fact that there's been whole shows, Big Gay Brunch, and
yeah.
Shane Monet had his I'm Coming Out show as well, and Iron Girders had Iron Grinders. So
it's so much fun. It's always like Big Gay Brunch, Iron Grinders, like the atmosphere was just so fun all day, and we need more of that. But as Shane Monet points out a lot, like a lot of wrestlers, we don't just want to be like the gay hire, like the like I think, especially coming from like a women's wrestling perspective as well, like a lot of the times you're on the card just to be the women's match, and you don't want to be like, oh, we can tick two boxes, we'll get the gay women, you know. So I like these shows for the fact that they're not ticking boxes, but it's getting some names out there as well. Like there was loads of people that I met at Big Gay Brunch that I hadn't seen on Instagram or Twitter or YouTube or anything before I went to TNT, and then after I met them, even shared a ring with them, I was like, oh, amazing, follow them. And I still follow them to this day, and I still think they're all class. And without the Rainbow Rumble, I would, myself and probably a lot of fans, probably would never have heard of these wrestlers, and they wouldn't be where they are today. So I think it's a really important platform that Effie and TNT and GCW, wherever it's getting hosted, is providing.
Yeah, it also provides a safe space for those that want to maybe come over to England or the UK to do that. Because I know a wrestler that we've had on, Keita Murray, who we've had on in the past, because I've known him since Bebo. That's how long I've known Keita Murray. And he's done the ones in the States, and he was expressing interest. He would love to go over and do one in the UK as well. It's this kind of launching pad to work in the UK. And the fact that can happen is always good, and it's happening UK wide and worldwide as well. So it's always a good thing to be able to see new people and to learn about new wrestlers. I mean, speaking of learning about new wrestlers, not long after that you had the King of the Fling match, which included Helen Charlotte Campbell as well.
Yeah.
Who of course, if I'm right in saying, trans. Yes. Okay. I'm very afraid that I'm going to say something wrong. So,
no.
But yeah, she's trans. So was hitting a lot of headlines because of that as well. And she's just treated as any other wrestler, as she should be. But what was it like getting in the ring with Helen?
The King of the Fling. Oh, that was such a fun match. And I was so... It was the first all-female King of the Fling, so I was so honoured to be part of that match. And Helen was so good to work with. She... So easy, like, you would just go like, oh, we're going to do this, we're going to do this. And she's like, yeah, great, do you mind taking this? And I'm like, yeah, cool, grand. So just so easy. She's such a lovely, lovely lassie as well. I've only met her twice. Met her at Big A Ranch and I met her at Iron Grinders. And honestly, lovely gal. Can't say a word wrong.
I suppose you came in at this time where wrestling was just becoming more, it's wrestling, it's a wrestling match, it's not men, women or anything like that, and you came through an environment where you were training with men, women, and you were just in the ring with whoever. So I suppose do you see a difference when it comes to how you're treated at shows? You mentioned tokenism, like just being the women's match. Do you know when you kind of get a booking, like, I know what my role is here. I'm the tick box here, but I'm still going to have one of the best. I'm going to try and have one of the best matches on the show. Do you still get that now?
Not really. I don't think so. Like, but you can sometimes tell they've just gone right. Two women, we'll just put them together. So we've got a women's match on the card, and where the only time it's ever happened is the women's match is the only one without a story in it, whereas like all the other matches are either championship matches for men's titles, or there's like a running storyline in the background, and you're just, but that's only ever happened to me a couple of times. Most of the companies I've worked for have gone, oh, we want this match because we want these wrestlers on the show. It's not, we want these women here because we need two women and these are the only two available. It's always been, no, we'd like this match on the show because we want these women fighting for our women's title, or we want these women on the show just to put on a good match because we know we can.
Yeah. I mean, it's not difficult, is it? It's not difficult just to put in a little blurb going, oh, we've got a women's match and the winner, or they'll be looking to move on to face the champion. It's like, it's, it takes very little effort for promotions to, if they are going to book a women's match, to just add three lines of text to make it a meaningful match, why it's on the card.
Yeah, and that's what I like about Girders, is both of the titles are, or all three of the titles are intergender, if we're counting the Acme Interpromotional. So anyone can win them. It's very much a meritocracy, like who can fight their way to the top or stay in the ring, depending on which title you're going for. And we've had, well, we've only ever had male champions for the heavyweight champion so far, but we've had both genders be King of the Fling. So I like that about Girders. There's not, there's never going to be a Girders women's championship as far as I'm aware. Mm-hmm. They're just, everyone's going for that one big belt that everyone wants.
Let's talk about belts then. I think we've held off long enough to talk about you winning the Community Pro Wrestling Women's Championship in a match that involved Nicole Jasmine, who you've had many a battle with, and Emerson Jane, probably one of the best wrestlers, probably one of the best wrestlers from Scotland in the UK right now. And you beat Ruby Robertson this weekend, you know, just to add that to the accolades list here. What was that like? Finally, about 2 years in, becoming a champion, holding that belt, and in the process beating, like I said, one of the best in the UK along the way. What was that like for you?
It was a stressful weekend to begin with. Like, one of the best weekends I've had, but finding out that Emerson was going to be in the final, I was like, oh, because I'd wanted to wrestle her for a long time, and I had been pushing Davey for quite a long time. I was like, can I wrestle Emerson Jane, please? Can I wrestle Emerson Jane, please? And he was like, I'll try. And then when he was like, yeah, we've got her, she'll be in the women's tournament, I was like, yes, let's go. And then that match, I think, when I won the title, that was one of the hardest matches I've ever had, because she's so good and all of her moves are so slick and clean, and I don't want to make her look bad by being bad, if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. So I had to be on my A game, because I need to prove, if I can beat her then and hold my own in the ring with her, then I'm worthy of the title. So I had to put on a good performance that day. And I think I did. I look back on that match and I'm like, yeah, it's not perfect, but it's a pretty damn good match. First time ever using a weapon as well in that match, because it was a triple threat, so I was allowed to bring the old chair in. And then, yeah, very emotional afterwards. I don't think I showed it on the official video, but as soon as I was back through that curtain, I started crying quite a lot. So,
do you feel that was the moment where everything kind of properly kicked off for you, though? Because I'm looking at your caliber of opponents after that, and had another title match for Attitude Pro, and then within that reign itself, you had Celine Ferry as well.
Yep.
I apologize if I've said that name wrong. Then you had Anita Vaughn as well, and then not just in CPW, you had Debbie Keitel, and then not just CPW, you had Jay Steins in Iron Girders as well. So did you feel once you won that title, you kind of leveled up to a point where you're just like getting all these big opponents to kind of prove your worth as a champion?
I think so. Like, I, as soon as I won that belt, I went and I was like, I'm the first title holder. If we're gonna make this title prestigious, then it needs to be defended against the best. So we need to bring the best in. And I think we did that. Like, Celine, oh, I can't remember if she's still OTT intergender champion, but she was at the time when I wrestled her for the CPW Women's Championship. So she's accomplished. Anita Vaughn, don't need to say, she's incredible, amazing. I don't often get flung about in a match, and Anita Vaughn flung me about like a wet trackie, and I loved every second of it, but I still won. So getting to do face Debbie Keitel and Lucy Sky in an unannounced triple threat, shock horror CPW, was incredible. Like, two of the fastest rising stars on the UK scene right now, Debbie and Lucy. So, and I won. So I think, yeah, and getting to wrestle Jay Steins for Girders and Stevenson, that was a great match. Like, I'd never met him before. I think another one where we only had like 3 hours to click before the show started. Oh, hay fever, apologies. And that was really fun getting to wrestle a lot of new people. There's a lot of people I've wrestled loads of times. Nicole Jasmine, Ruby Roberts, Angel Hayes, wrestled them a million times. But getting to wrestle new people is really exciting, and especially new opponents of that caliber is very exciting. World traveled folk who've been there, done everything, and then they're coming here and I'm able to hold my own in the ring with them and win. That's great. It's always good.
And I mean, not only you got to have that match with Emerson, you had to share her with everyone else in that match, but you actually got a one-on-one match with her as well. In Shawlins, not after you lost the title, with under circumstances we'll speak about, because I do have a couple of questions about the CPW's treatment of you recently. But so you had to share Emerson with the others, or with one other, on that night. But then you got to have her one-on-one. Was that more nerve-wracking, because it was both of you instead? There wasn't a third person to kind of maybe work through.
It was terrifying. I didn't get a lot of notice for that match either. That was another one of my last minute drop in my raison d'etre, shall we say. So that was the last one. I think I only had a week's notice for that match, and I spent the whole week throwing up. I was so nervous. I wanted to do well. And then I think the match with Emerson and Shawlins is one of the best matches I've ever had in my career, because she's so good, and she pushed me to my absolute limit in that match. She Germaned me like 4 times, so if that's not pushing me to my limit, then I don't know what is.
She's got one mean German suplex, if there ever was one.
I'm well aware.
I know. I'm just watching it and going,
my spine is well aware.
Well, speaking of your spine, on Friday, as of this going out, Friday the 13th of September, not a lucky day, as we've already found out through tech difficulties.
Yeah.
You're in the first ever women's ticket to the top ladder match for CPW. Yes. So for those that are unaware, the tickets are probably sold out, because this card, as of now, as we're recording on the 29th of August, is insane as it is. You're going to be in a ladder match with Anita Vaughn, Cassie Cook, Raven Creed, Emerson Jane, and Millie McKenzie. So this was a match that you actually asked for. Maybe not. Yeah. Maybe you didn't give them a list of names you wanted in the match, but it was a match you asked for. And if you thought getting a German suplex by Emerson was going to be an issue. Yeah,
Millie's going to put me through a ladder. I can already tell. I'm going to try my best not to let her put me through a ladder, but she's so good. She's so talented. She's so young. Like, all the things you hate but can't help admire.
Yeah.
And yeah, she's up there, like, with the best the UK's ever produced already, and she's what, 23? I don't know her exact age. So, like, it's hurts me in my chest, but she's got so many ceilings to smash through. still, and I can't wait to finally meet her and wrestle her. Very excited, and hopefully she doesn't German me through a ladder. But
I've just did the old Google on the cage match just to check 24.
Oh, that makes it so much better.
Oh,
that 1 year of difference.
A 1 year of experience, that hardened experience. God, 10 years younger than me. Oh, my back hurts just considering that. But how are you? This is so you mentioned that you got to use your a weapon for the first time in that triple threat. How are you with ladders?
Well, considering I requested this match, albeit in the heat of the moment, I don't like climbing ladders.
And I've seen the ladders that CPW use. It's the ones that's got like the nice rung on one side and like the
nothing big spacers on the other. Yeah, and I'm all right with heights. Heights don't scare me at all. I can jump off things. I've been like abseiling. That's grand. Would love to go bungee jumping one day, but I don't like climbing ladders. I had to climb a wee step stool in work today, and I didn't enjoy that, and that was two steps. So I'm still going to win the match, but someone might need to help me climb the ladder.
Well, there you go. Maybe that's a little spoiler ahead. Possibly, especially with this vegan agenda with Martin McAllister. You know, who knows? It's no disqualification.
I'm not saying anything.
That's absolutely understandable.
But if Martin would like to come help me climb the ladder, or at least hold it still, then I'm not going to say no.
So I mean, moving on a little bit back to the chat with Ella, we're talking about Taylor Swift. So we're gonna get into some Taylor Swifting for the moment. So you mentioned how your gear is very much Taylor inspired.
Yes.
Was I right in hearing and remembering that you were able to attend one of the Eras tours?
One.
Two. Oh, all right. Wrestlers do well then.
I sold my flat to go. Not even a joke.
So how was it? Was it the I can't think of, this is just a common occurrence thing. I can't think of any words.
We're both rubbish with words.
One of us has to try and host a podcast, though. One of us should be good at this. Yeah, was it the experience you wanted and more on those two nights?
It was incredible. And we had seats because, I'm old and my back hurts, so I don't think I could have standed for the... I mean, Taylor's set alone was 3.5 hours, so... And then Paramore were the support, which are also one of my favourite bands. So I would have been standing for maybe 5 hours straight if I'd got standing tickets. So I made the sensible judgment to get us seating tickets. So we got a wee break, but it was incredible. And it was my first time being able to see her live because she hasn't played Scotland since like early 2010s, when I would have had to have begged my mum for ticket money that she wouldn't have paid. So it was my first time seeing her, and it was incredible. And getting to dress up and my wee fearless dress, I loved it. Loved it. Cowboy boots was great.
Well, we've got a question about that from Lily McLeod, who takes loads of pictures at the CPW shows, does great stuff there. I'm just asking your fave Taylor Swift era and why.
I mean, it is Reputation. I could break it up, but no, Reputation. You've got the snakes. You've got, because I love snakes. Got a snake tattoo and everything. So you've got the snakes. Like, the album's like a bit rap, a bit rock. So it's a bit like more edgy than her stuff had been before. But then at the heart of it, Reputation is a love album. And I'm a big sap. So I am a Reputation girly forever. When is she going to announce Reputation's Taylor's version? That's what I want to know. This hasn't been announced yet.
And
I thought she was going to do it on the last Wembley show. I clowned so hard for the final night at Wembley. She was going to announce it. And then it would have been 8 weeks till the Miami show. And that 8 weeks is the time it takes for like pre-orders to count towards your first week album sales. So I was like, oh, she's obviously going to do it then. She didn't.
I'm a fearless guy myself. Personally, Mainly because I had there, like, when I used to work, I used to drive like an hour and a half to get to work and then an hour and a half on the way home. I had like a few albums that I would play on my old CD player in the car.
Yes.
And yeah, Fearless was one of them. And it was just in the summer,
Banger.
get that window down, put on Fearless, and tune
Yes.
after tune after tune.
Banger. No skips. It's a no skips album.
Absolutely. And then I've kind of fell out a little bit of Taylor Swifting because I don't really listen to the radio anymore. So, but every so often a song passes by my TikTok or something, and she still puts on a fair
Oh,
show. I mean, I watched the
puts on a
show on Disney
great show.
Plus, and I sat there for like 3 hours, and my arse was getting sore. So, God, thinking being there for 5 hours, and I mean, I would have loved to have seen Paramore, but
Yeah.
I think I would have had to like definitely would have had to try and sneak in some paracetamol or something just to make it to
Oh.
the end.
The walk back into Edinburgh City Centre in my cowboy boots was not comfortable, shall we say, because we were having to kind of walk quite quickly because we had a bus booked, and it was not comfortable, but I took them off on the bus. So classy.
I was gonna say it's one of those where you notice your age automatically, because my first thought there was, oh, yeah, I bet you wish you bought some insoles or something just to cushion it.
It's the pointy toes on the cowboy boots. They're not comfortable.
But it has to be done. Have to be done for
Yeah.
a bit of Taylor Swift. Other Taylor Swift question I've got is actually from my other half, who is in our Taylor Swift zone at the moment. If I have to listen to any more Taylor Swift downstairs, I don't mind. I don't mind actually. But she's just asking, if Taylor was to get into the old wrestling game, what gimmick would you picture?
Well, she used to babysit Jeff Jarrett's kids, so surely she's got to have like a Jeff Jarrett gimmick. Kind of Jeff Jarrett mixed with Elias or Elijah, as he's going now. Songs in the ring. And I think she's got to go full cocky. She can't go like Miss Americana, like all American babyface. She's got to go like cocky, like reputation still, like I'm the biggest gal on the planet. You will listen to me sing a heel promo in the ring and then hit you with a guitar.
So what you're saying is, get her with Joe Hendry,
Yes. Oh.
although getting
Oh.
a Taylor Swift version of My World, oh my God, I'm Jeff Jarrett, if you're listening.
I would love, oh, Taylor Swift and Jeff Jarrett versus me and Joe Hendry, dream match booking. Yeah. Let's get Discovery to book that. Let's go.
That's it, Discovery. You get it on it. That's it.
I'm sure they've got Taylor Swift's number.
You know what? I would not be shocked if Joe Hendry had Taylor Swift's number at this point. Nothing that man does is going to shock me now, with the things that he's accomplished. And I mean, when we speak, he could be NXT champion. That's a possibility
I
that's in
hope
the
he is.
future. Anyway, right, we do have some more questions that we're going to throw at you. We've got Lily back here with, what is it like constantly being screwed over by CPW management?
I don't know what I did to annoy them, but it's getting beyond a joke at this point. Like it was like haha when the matches kept getting made triple threats last second, but they just keep doing it. It happened at Hamilton. That was meant to be me and Debbie one on one, and then Emerson just walks out the curtain with no explanation.
I mean, that's one of
Like,
those where when it happens, you're like, all right, okay, cool. That's
yeah, like, I mean, it was a cool experience, but at the same time, I was like, what is she doing here? This was meant to be a singles match. I've yet to have my promised one on one with Debbie Keitel.
then
One
just
day.
climb the ladder. That's it.
I climb the ladder, win that briefcase, and Debbie, I will be waiting for you. Or you'll be waiting for me. You'll not see me coming though.
I just made it sound so easy. I just go climb the ladder and be
I
fine. Oh, good.
just
As
as
long
long as
as
someone holds it for me.
Martin, get on it. We've got Judas asking DMG.
I don't know what this means. I
Oh
seen
no.
this reply and I'm like googling it like he's so young. And yeah, he's another young, talented ugh. Awful.
Okay. DMG
I
is.
googled it and it said damage, like in a like in a game, and I was like, I've got 100 XP. We're fine. I take no damage.
Okay. Do you want to know what it stands for then?
Yeah.
It stands for Dead Mum Gang.
Oh, no, my mum's alive.
Cool. That's fine.
Shout out my mum. She's alive. Yeah.
No dead man. Dead Mum Gang for you. Ace.
No.
That's always good. There's going to be a day I'm going to ask that and they're going to turn around and go, oh, my mum died. hasn't happened yet. But one day it will. We've got an amazing question on the old Twitter as well. I need to go find it.
Is this the one from my mum who is alive?
Oh, is it your mum?
That's
even
my mum.
Better.
Proof that she's alive. And the answer is I don't know. I've forgotten most of my degree.
So for those that are unaware, it is I cannot find this question, which is annoying me even more. I will find it because it was.
She asked, like, can you explain the wave density function? I'm like, no, mother, I cannot. So
that's like, don't need it. I'm assuming if you do, that's a bit worrying.
Because that's quantum mechanics, and I'm in the nuclear game, so different things.
There we go. What is the formula for wave function probability density?
Yes. So, who cares?
Yeah.
Not me.
Google it. It's fine.
Yeah.
I'm sure the answer will be there.
I'm pretty sure my physics textbook is still in her house. She can go look it up.
Yeah, do the work yourself.
Love you, Mum.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Mrs. Armstrong. We do have another question from Charlie Watson. First Chip Watson, as he may better be known, or
Chips. I loved watching him getting smacked with that lettuce. That was beautiful. Oh, stunning.
Is that your dream weapon? If you were able to just a lettuce.
I'm raging that someone's done it before me, to be honest. Like, that's gimmick infringement, but it was still beautiful to see. It was stunning.
Now he's asked a question that I will have follow ups about. It is favorite vegan friendly takeaway order.
So, if we're going bog standard, like, takeaway that's not catered towards vegans, I'm not talking like a chain that has vegan options. I'm talking about your, like, your basic, this village only has one Indian and one chippy basic. It would be, if we're going chippy, just chips and curry sauce. Can't go wrong. Or a roll and fritter, but a dry roll, obviously.
Hmm.
If we're going to the Indian, vegetable pakora and hot chili sauce. Stunning. Can't go wrong with vegetable pakora. Even when I ate meat, I chose vegetable pakora because it's just superior. And anyone can fight me over that and I'll win because it's just superior. If the takeaway caters to vegans... So our go-to takeaway in this house is from the Red Tiffin on Duke Street in Glasgow. Shout out the Red Tiffin. They have a full vegan section of their menu and I get a chana masala and naan bread, which is just chickpeas and masala sauce. It's beautiful. But my friends and I had a vegan Chinese night on Sunday night just there, where we ordered from this Chinese. It's like a chain across the UK, but it's called Wawin. I think that's how you pronounce it. But they're completely vegan, fully 100% vegan. And we got a hot honey and chili special, which was basically just every type of meat that they had in this hot honey chili sauce thing. And it was beautiful. It was stunning. Would order again. So if you're in Glasgow or Manchester or London, go to Wawin.
So I do have follow-ups because... Yes. Of course, one of my favourite things that you did, and I spoke about it in our little chat at Peterhead, was you did the top 10 vegan alternatives, which is still one of my favourite things that went up on the website, mainly because of things like some of the companies actually picked it up and like shared it and all that kind of stuff, and that was just incredible. But I remember on that day you said to me that you've got a top 10 takeaway. List coming, and it's been a while.
It hasn't happened yet. Oh,
so
yeah, I'm really bad for that. I will make one. Shall we wait for Veganuary, or will I just do it?
whenever you got the time, I will take it.
Do we give a spoiler at what number one is?
Or do we wait? Is it just what you've mentioned? Or
no, it's not, because I forgot what my actual top, because I don't think of it as a takeaway, what my actual top one is.
Let's keep it under wraps.
Suspense.
Mainly because you'll probably start the list and go, oh no, move this year and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. We'll just leave it there. So, no, it is one of the favorite things the way up there, just because it was just. Again, you're
it's
like
a
this.
Random thing to do.
You're like the little, like the savior of the site, though, because the first time when I needed someone to jump in and to fill out a spot on the podcast, you were there, and I needed someone to fill a spot in the website, because otherwise I'd break my streak.
Last minute dropping. Only me that cares about this.
And there you are. Ellie Armstrong saves the day and gets me a fantastic list that
I edit my name to Ellie Last Minute Armstrong on this, or is it too late?
Names doesn't appear anyway. So well that. So looking ahead, I don't know how much, I don't know if we're gonna hit the hour after we've got to take out the chunk of time, but we've got plenty of other things we could throw in there. Wrestling at Comic Con.
Oh,
how was that?
I haven't done it yet.
I mean, I thought it was one of
It's
the matches.
coming up.
Ah, right. I think I
it's
was
not been announced
up
yet, so that's a wee
I think I was
kind
mixed up a fireworks festival with that Comic Con.
The fireworks festival was very fun, very cold. Why we were doing an outdoor show in November, I don't know. But luckily it didn't rain, but it was freezing.
Oh, speaking of, was it the Aki show, the Aki Aki's that was raining?
Absolutely tipping it down. It was like it was spitting for the, so we were second match on. It was spitting for the first match, but it wasn't too bad for most of it. And then as they went towards the end of their match, the heavens opened, like the crowd were all sitting outside, and it was just one of those things where like they weren't leaving, so we couldn't postpone the match. So they just came around and were like, "Are you okay to do this?" And we're like, yeah, sure. Like, we don't really have it. We didn't really have any like high spots. And Emerson was like, "I just won't go off the top rope for the drop kick." She did.
Of course she did.
I was terrified. I turned around expecting a normal standing drop kick, and there she is on the top, and I'm like, oh god, oh. But yeah, the heavens just rained the whole match, and we were the only match where the heavens were open for the full match, I think. And I mean, the puddles were actually made the bumps nicer, but at the same time it was cold and wet and that was new gear, and I was like, why am I doing this? And I curled my hair for no reason.
I looked at the photos and my again because I'm an old man, my initial thought was, well, hope we don't stand on the vinyl lettering in the middle of the because they'll just fall.
Luckily, the canvas that was on, I don't think. Oh no, it did have vinyl lettering. Oh, I was running about and everything. Oh dear. I could have died.
It would be a very different chat.
not accidentally, because I would do it anyway, but I slammed Debbie at one point and then went for my cartwheel. And normally when I'm like a baddie, before I go for the cartwheel, if it's not straight after the belly to belly, I'll do the whole like, oh, wiping my shoes on the mat thing. But that was just complete like automatic, and I forgot that there was puddles in the ring, and she got absolutely sprayed with dirty boot water, and I was like, I'm so sorry, I just forgot there was puddles in the ring. The photos look cool though. Kyle's photos were class, so. But Kyle's photos are always class, but it was nice to see them like outdoors in the rain. You don't see outdoor rain photos from wrestling very often, so.
No, but so there you go. There you go, Kyle. We shout out for you. Right, we started speaking about Comic Con and ended up in that. So, so you've got a Comic Con match coming up. It'll be announced in however many days or whatever. It might be announced by the time that this episode goes out. We don't know, but it wouldn't be your first foray into dressing up for a wrestling show.
Oh.
Because I distinctly remember a Halloween show for Iron Girders, and you dressed as a pumpkin.
Oh, I'm not gonna top that. Like, I did Barbie the next year, but like the Pumpkin Spice Warehouse will never be beaten. Like, It was a horrific costume to wrestle in. When I did my cartwheel, it completely covered my face. The hat kept falling off, but I had a great time. So fun. Like, and just the Girders Halloween shows, that's what I'm saying. Like, they're in the Girders gym, so the crowd are amazing. And then everyone's all dressed up. There's always, like, the crowd usually come dressed up, so they're all well up for it. And I think the Girders Halloween shows are my favourite shows that I do.
They've announced the next one as well, haven't
yeah.
they?
Yeah.
So, the pumpkin, though, you said it was a terrible costume, practicality's sake. Yep. Was that one of the ones where you thought it was an amazing idea, then you put it on and were just like, ah, no.
Yeah, like, I bought it the moment I was confirmed to be on the show, and it was just off Amazon. And then when it arrived, I was like, oh, there's a... I thought it was, like, shut at the bottom, and I thought I could maybe just get away with wearing it as, like, a singlet. But no, it was just open. So I was like, oh, I'm going to need to wear, like, gym leggings underneath this. And then I was like, oh, what t-shirt do I wear? I don't have an orange t-shirt, so I think I'm wearing like a white t-shirt, just hoping it'll blend in. And it was one of those things that was a heat of the moment, and I bet I could have got a better one if I'd spent more than 3 seconds on Amazon typing pumpkin costume for adults and buying the cheapest one I could find.
So you mentioned Barbie was the year after. From our chat so far, I'm assuming it's something to be Taylor Swift related. But what's on your mind? For is there any hints or tips that we could see?
I have not thought about it. I have, but I don't know if that'll happen. I'd love to dress as someone, but them not know. So, like, say I got a match with, like, with Moxie or something, and I come out and I'm dressed as her. Like, that's really funny to me. It's probably not funny to anyone else, but if I don't let her, like, I'll just wear a big t-shirt all day and she'll not know when I'll come through the curtain. I'm like, haha, she's dyed her hair green now as well, so it would work.
Yeah. Or just get, like, a bald cap and just start chopping folk like your BT gun. You know, it's, there's ways that could be done.
I don't think I would suit the BT gun trunks, though. I know, so I'd have to wear a t-shirt. Yeah.
So moving forward, then we mentioned Made of Hell that's coming up. We've kind of teased some things about Comic Con. What's your kind of outlook for opponents that you want to face? And I know I ask this question every time I do this, and the answer is always the same. I want to fight anyone, but you know, who do you want?
I'll give you a list. So I've tagged with them, but I would like either a tag match or a one-on-one with Vanity, Ronan King, and Judas Grey.
Yes.
They're young and talented and annoying, but they're incredible wrestlers. So I would like either a tag or a one-on-one with either or together. Handicap match, I don't care. I've never had a match with Charlie Vice, and he's made his big comeback. So I'd love to wrestle Charlie Vice. Branching out a bit, Session Moth, obviously. She's incredible. Lana Austin, still to wrestle her. She's been at the top of my list for quite some time. I think that's who I can think of off the top of my head that I've never wrestled and would like to wrestle. I've never had a one-on-one with Daisy Jenkins. Only ever tags or triple threats. So, and she's shot. She's amazing. So, and is getting her well-deserved recognition for it. So I'd like a wee one-on-one with Daisy Jenkins as well.
That all seems absolutely possible. So hopefully by the time that we eventually work around and get another chat.
In 3 years' time, that'll all have happened, yeah. Well,
imagine I'm still doing this in 3 years. Surely I would have ran out by now. but no, I'm looking forward to, I'm glad that we were able to get this this catch up done, because like I said, the 3 minutes we had, the 5 minutes we had in Peterhead were an absolute nightmare because you were such a good bad guy. So, yeah. You know, how can I be mad at that when the reason there were the kids were so rebellious is because you did your job well.
Yeah.
last time I also got the, because I'm a trading card guy now, I actually tried to contact TNT and they did not come back to me. So
tried to get
an Ellie Armstrong traded card. So if anyone from TNT is listening, I'll take a defect. Just like, give one. I'll take it.
Photocopy.
Yeah, let me see it. I don't even know what they look like.
Someone tweeted me at once, and that's the closest I've come to seeing it. I never even got to see them in person. So,
I mean, you're a Pokemon kid as well, aren't you? But that must have been. Well, you don't have it, but knowing that you were.
But it exists was surreal. Exists, yeah.
Yeah. But I've got the Ellie Armstrong sticker, although it went through the washing machine. But it's still one piece. It just doesn't stick to anything now.
Just laminate it.
Say for anyone that wants to get an Ellie Armstrong sticker, just know they're hardy. They last one wash in a jeans pocket.
That can't confirm was in if there. It's more than one.
Oh yeah, I don't want to try again. just in case. But it's in a little pocket, so it's like a trading card, I suppose. Anyway, I got sidetracked on the wrap up, We'll come back. Before we wrap up then, you mentioned on Ella's your favourite Taylor Swift songs, but you did kind of say that it was like picking some of your favourite children. Since that chat, have you been able to narrow it down a little bit more, or is it still like,
I can't even remember what ones I gave her. So I said Betty. So Betty's definitely top five for the reasons I gave Ella. It's my granny's name. It's the first song she swears on. Which is, you know, it's exciting. And Folklore, that was well needed at that stage of the pandemic. But again, I can't remember what ones I told her, so I don't know.
Sorry, after all the tech issues, I've just ended it by just putting you into an anxious panic instead.
Because I just want to say all of them. Right now, I'm still very much listening to Tortured Poets Department. And then Reputation. So it's got to be. I'm gonna get you back at the moment. That's made its way into the rotation for sure. But yeah, it is like fucking a favorite child. Because I've got, it depends what mood I'm in. If I'm sad, it's gonna be Folklore Evermore. But if I'm like buzzing, it's gonna be more of a Fearless Speak Now situation. So.
Well, for me, nothing beats window down, our song comes on, shouting it on the way to whatever, between Elgin and Newport Sligo, just screaming our song down the road. Anyway, I think that's a good place to wrap up. So for those that need to or haven't got a ticket yet, get your tickets to Welcome to Mary Hell. Not only is that ticket to the top ladder match happening, we've also got matches with Debbie Keitel taking on Nicole Jasmine for the CPW Women's Championship. I know, we've got into it already. It should be your match, but you know, Debbie's got her rematch.
Nicole's got her rematch.
Nicole, oh, I'm so confused about who's champion in these places. Oh yeah, I've got that wrong then. Attitude Pro and CPW. It's like my brain hurts when I'm trying to do these things. Anyway, take it to the top ladder match. We've got that tag team match, Casino Brutale, new CPW tag team champions. Meat Wagon are up to take on the Govan team.
I should hate Meat Wagon, but I love them. They're such nice guys.
It's a common occurrence when it comes to wrestling when you look at someone and go, oh, you're so damn good. I hate you. Judas being the prime example, as we've mentioned already.
Hate Judas. I hate him.
I know.
That's on record. Judas, I hate you.
And Sam Del Vale's coming up to wrestle Ravy Davies. So amazing match. And you're in the marquee match of the event as well. Gangrel's out.
A wee shame. I really wanted to meet Gangrel.
Gangrel was ace. I met him for Arianarchy and he was just like, I thought when I met him, oh my God, you're not going to be good at this. You look like your hips are about to explode. And then the Brood music hit, and out he came, like it was 1998. This is the best thing ever. So all those, get your tickets if you can do, if you haven't already, if they're not already sold out, which I'm sure they are, because look at that ladder match in itself, and then the rest of the matches.
It's my birthday, so
there you go.
You need to come.
Happy birthday to Ella Armstrong and Ellie. What am I doing? Ellie Armstrong and by winning the ladder match and
I will
beating.
I promise.
Whoever the champion is at the end of the night, just do go Bailey style, just win it and then
cash it straight back in. Oh,
yeah. Why waste time? Why waste time holding a briefcase for any longer than you have to? Plug your socials. We're in a panic now for some reason, but yeah.
It is at elliearmstrong.pw on Instagram. It is at eyelid with four D's on TikTok. It is Ellie Armstrong on Facebook. And then it's, if you search Ellie Armstrong on Twitter/X, it comes up. But I had to finicky with the at handle because Ellie Armstrong was taken. So there's extra eyes in there somewhere. You'll find me. I'm there somewhere.
Just look for Ellie Armstrong on the interweb. You'll find her. Yeah. There, but great. Thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me again.
Thank you for having me on.
We'll meet again at some point, probably in Peterhead.
3 years time. 3 years time.
And yep, 3 years time. 2020.
Oh, don't say it. Don't say it.
My maths just died in that moment. Seven.
Yeah. That's horrible.
Let's wrap up and go and all that stuff. But yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.